We certainly believe in transparency in government. We certainly believe in good governance. And I use the phrase all the time, peace, order, and good government. And of course, we as a government, just the UDP government, had to implement the freedom of information. And that was and is still challenging. But there are limits. For instance, the proceeding of cabinet can't be public. But of course, all pertinent matters that can be publicized should be publicized as quickly as possible. And that's something that we will seek to do. Also, certain boards here in the country, not every board, but certain boards can be public. We have to be mindful, and some people clamor for that, but we have to be mindful that there are people that are serving on boards that are not paid individually, they give free time, and they stand to take, and to put it simply, a lot of licks, and might not want to give up their professional career to that sort of scrutiny. So we have to be careful, because all our boards are volunteer boards. We certainly believe that as a new government, we will have appropriate press briefings when necessary, and national debates on national issues. Also, I certainly would push for the continued development and implementation of our district councils, which are constitutionally due. The Constitution says we must have them. And this is a means that we can have openness and participation and a participative democracy. And of course, I come back again to that matter of a development of a national body that will not have legislative powers, but are broad-based in skills. To discuss legislation, to discuss government policies, to discuss various treaties and so on. Not a Senate as such, but a similar body to keep watch on the assembly and other national matters. That is something that I believe that is needed, and I believe that can give openness, transparency, and give us a participative democracy. I don't know how you would determine two. I don't know who could determine two with all the things that are happening globally, and certainly happening even nationally here. There are more than two. But in the short term, jobs and the cost of living are the two most pressing issues for our islands. In the short term, we need to address the matters to ensure also our financial services industry, that it remains competitive, our tourism industry, what kind of tourism industry we want. We plan to have what kind of tourism industry we want for our short term, long term. And we plan to continue that. But there are pressing matters of how do we address the income? How do we address the impact that the global economy has made on our local economy? People not working, loss of employment, loss of homes, loss of just not being able to pay bills. So how do we address it? Well, there are several projects that we would have to put in place. What we do have to mind is that government can only do so much. How many of the big projects can we get in the ground between May this year and December? Let's say if you look at all them, airport, dock, sewage systems, can't. Not with the FFR and the way that the governor sees good governance. It has stymied any rush forward to help people. That's what happened to us as a government. Now we have to find a way to work through the FFR. But there are short-term programs that we are going to have to employ to be able to help people throughout that period, May until December. And that is something that we are addressing and that we will bring to the forefront once we publicize our manifesto. We have the right plans. And there are things that we have to be mindful of. Firstly, financing our government. How do we do it? The core principles, the revenue generation, how to enhance government's economic efficiency, government expenditures, and then bearing in mind that we have a four-year budget with the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, and that we have the FFR to contend with. So these are things that from the government point of view, how do we address, how do we get the revenue? And then working hard at keeping government balance, keeping the country from going belly up, our key economic strategies, and that is growing through skills and innovation and economic diversification policy. Some of government things can be diversified. The Foreign Commonwealth Office agreed with me on certain matters. The financial services, manufacturing in Cayman, a technology Cayman program. Technology is growing fast in so many different areas, utilized for Cayman Alliance and such investors that can and willing to put roots in Cayman. Health City, Cayman Islands. The special economic zones utilize Cayman as a jurisdiction for clinical trials and experimental research. Of course, investment in Owen Roberts International Airport, Cayman Airways, a cruising berthing facility, a national sewage system, and anchor Cayman as the global America's hub, build a vibrant and diverse corporate ecosystem. These are things that people worldwide is looking wild, and I've always maintained we're small enough, strong enough. We have still a very good infrastructure. We got to build on it, we know. But in comparison to competitors, Cayman is still on top, I think. Build a very good infrastructure so that can enhance and complement any industry that we want. And there are certain industries that we can build, some micro, with heritage, arts and culture. Building our tourism, as I said a while ago, certainly can be enhanced, and it's something that we are going to do a lot more. We have done a lot in the last 4 years, and where, in fact, Cayman's tourism is the best that it has been in 12 years. And if I could do that in a time when the global economy has impacted millions of people, where millions of people are not traveling anymore, but to entice the quality visitor that can spend the kind of money to build. So not just numbers, but quality. In politics, probably too long. But I've been there long enough to know and see where Cayman has come from. There's a myth in this country that part of politics is a bad thing. How else do you run a government under the Westminster system, the kind of constitution that we have? How else do you do it? You have to do it by structure. You have to know before you go to vote who and where they're going to vote, what it is that's propelling a candidate, either to say they're independent or to say that they're a party. What is propelling them? Who is going to work behind the scenes with them, or who is working behind the scenes with them? Who is paying their bills? A party system, you know, we know what is proposed. We have to have a manifesto. We have to have guiding principles that we sign on to. And our party, and I'll speak about the United Democratic Party, our party has gained a new life with a new chairman who is a very business woman and knows how to conduct it. And so the people can expect better governance with a group that is founded on a core basis rather than the whims and fancies at any minute in time. We saw that. I saw that in the House before. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. We didn't get ahead because we didn't have parties and there were independents. I didn't build all the school facilities because of that. I built it because the national team operated as a party. And we even call it a national team. It could have been the national party, because we operated on core principles. We operated on how to work with each other, and we got things done. And then, of course, there was an absence of all this bureaucracy. So I think the people can expect better governance. And it's not the party. It is the person that is elected. Is that person a worker? Show me your skills. Show me what you've done for people. Show me how you operate in your community. Or you just go to church and say, I'm a good fella, and I can run, and I went to college, and I have an education, or I have a degree. That does not cut it. Do you really care about people? Can people approach your home? Can people approach your wife? Can they call her up and talk to her on a basis that she can talk to you and tell you what parents and mothers and children need in the community? That's what makes the difference in an elected person, independent or a party person. Last several terms they have, and I don't think I've let them down. Everybody knows that there was a vindictive attack on me personally, and everybody knows about yesterday. Well, yesterday was the Governor's Day. The future is about the people and what they will find out and what they will know, more than they already know about me, and so I'm relieved to that extent. But the people of West Bay only have to look at my operations in the last 28 and a half years. All the things I've just said. Can people approach me? Can they come to my home? Did I do things for them? Well, yes. When I got to West Bay, when I got elected in West Bay, people were still using outside toilets. There were very poor families that didn't have bathroom facilities. I don't know if you can go through the district today and find that. If it is, it's very few. I can look back on people that I personally, not government money, went out and raised funds to build homes for people. People who today are criticizing me, but nevertheless, I did it out of the goodness of heart. And first of all, you got to have that. You got to have a good heart to deal with people. What can you do for people? Me, I founded the Golden Age Home in West Bay. The Minister of Finance in the last government built, found the money for the additions to the new school. Of course, the Minister of Education is taking credit for it, but I was the Minister of Finance and had to find the funding, not just for that school, but for all the schools in all the districts. A health clinic with an ambulance service. We implemented a housing program that brought dozens of homes to Caymanians. First time ever support on the building of after-school programs. Launching ramps that we didn't have before, parks that we didn't have before, public beach that we didn't have before, cemetery expansion and revitalization that we didn't have before. We just got 5 acres of land for West Bay for a new cemetery from the Dart Group. Cricket facility, sports facilities, the redevelopment of the even the old field, the town hall, what we call the town hall field, new post office, the Clement Wells building, built it for 400 and something thousand, while other districts were building humongous operations in a district without any putting in any government services for over $1 million. West Bay can last with 10,000 people for just under $400,000. Basketball facilities for churches, on and on. A jet in central West Bay. Even in my term, and I personally went out and assisted the United Church by getting a large donation of $300,000 from a private individual for the renovation of their church hall and youth facilities. That $300,000 came from that. When they got Caymanian status, they gave us those funds for that. So people want to know, they look around them. That's the best evidence. Did West Bay suffer? There are social issues that have cropped up and will continue to crop up over my 28 years, and will crop up even more because the world has changed and globally things have changed, and impacting our national economy impacts our district economy, and in fact really impacts the man on the street most. So those are things that we now have to work on. I'm putting out a district manifesto, which we will publicize on Tuesday night in West Bay, at the Beulah's Powers, Mrs. Beulah Powers' yard, which is on the roadside in Northwest Point, 7:30. We invite everyone to come out to that meeting. They will hear and see some interesting things. I'm proud that I have two new candidates with me and Captain Eugene. Captain Eugene Ebanks and myself. He's a soldier, he's a worker, he knows the people. Bernie Bush is a worker, and so is Mrs. Velma Hewitt. They are workers from Rotary to the football field to church, to you name it. And those two people have been involved. And so you can look again, we are workers. They can check my background. There's going to be a lot of things said, of course. And the paragons of virtue is going to come out in the community and cry shame and make accusation. It's not over till it's over.